enabled.
The second edition of UBM India Pharma Week was held recently in Mumbai. A week full of events, the summit alongside CPhI and P-MEC India focused on business, leadership, innovation and networking in the field of pharma. The objective of the summit was to highlight latest knowledge and trends within the industry. The week-long Pharma Summit commenced with a plant visit where local and international attendees were given factory tours arranged by UBM India. This was followed by a golf tournament, where top management of leading pharmaceutical companies networked over a friendly game of golf. The tournament ended with the winning pharma professionals being felicitated.
I've been associated with India Pharma Week for a couple of years now. The big change I'm seeing in this whole thing is I'm seeing the emphasis on women. Women being given a complete thing, a section for that. That's great. And another big thing I'm seeing is a lot of, companies from overseas are coming over and using this opportunity to network and to meet other people.
India Pharma Week is the week which probably the entire pharmaceutical industry of India is looking forward to, not only this year, but yearly, last year also, and the years to come. Because it is that platform where actually converges the pharmaceutical industry of India, and different trends in the industry are actually seen. And the most important thing is this golf event wherein you are bringing in the CEOs. There will be competitors playing as team together. So it is going to be a very interesting event.
Coming up, the Pharma Pre-Connect Congress and the award ceremony. Day 3 of the second edition of India Pharma Week commenced with the Pre-Connect Congress. The overarching theme for this session was Ideate, Innovate and Integrate. It offered the congregation of leaders heading large pharmaceutical organizations a platform to discuss, deliberate and share thoughts on achieving the next phase of growth for the pharma industry.
CPhI and P-MEC is UBM's flagship engagement platform and the world's leading pharmaceutical networking event. Within the realm of the India Pharma Week, the Pre-Connect Congress, the pharma leaders' destination, stands out as one of the most prestigious events under the leadership and knowledge streams in the pharma domain. It's an honor to have renowned leaders such as yourselves, who head up large pharmaceutical organizations and propel them to reach new heights of success in this unique platform. With the theme of Ideate, which is innovate, and integrate as a backdrop, I'm extremely eager to hear your recommendations to achieve the next phase of growth for the Indian pharma domain.
CPhI over the years has become a landmark event and a must for any pharmaceutical business to attend. And not only that, it has over the years evolved into a platform for sharing of ideas. I compliment UBM for this. And then, so I was thinking like what CPhI has done for India, maybe for other parts of the world. So getting the buyers and sellers means more opportunities of, or more sources for suppliers of the ingredients. That means more opportunities and possibly reduced costs and more affordability to the patients of not only India, maybe of the world as well.
In the future of healthcare, so first and foremost, what I need to, I've been saying that even in the various industry forum, Particularly, India is in a very unique situation as compared to any other country. India is one country where we have chosen a different kind of a healthcare system. And we should really say a big thanks to the pharma industry, particularly in India, where the pharma industry has been able to provide affordable and accessible medicine to the common man, where we are able to make a big difference. Are we here to celebrate? I don't think so. I think we have a long way to go. We need to start defining a well thought out patient care pathway. My humble request is, we don't live alone in healthcare industry. We are very much part of an ecosystem, and each member of the ecosystem need to recognize the tugs and pulls of each and every member of the community, and being sensitive and making sure that we all work with a common purpose of serving the patient, who is at the center of purpose of all of us are living, coming over here for this meeting. If we don't have what it takes to serve the patient, then we shouldn't be wasting our time being part of this industry.
The first panel discussion of the day was on the topic Vision 2020, gearing up for the next phase of growth. Leaders stitched together a blueprint for the future, which aimed at making India one of the leading destinations for end-to-end drug discovery and innovation. Through this platform, they also highlighted the need for the government to continue to provide support by way of infrastructure and scientific manpower.
Where do you think, or what are the growth and challenges, your perspectives, for Indian pharma to go to the next level for 2020?
The issue that we have today is tremendous price erosion. It's been there for ages. So as with the generic industry, you know, there's a huge upside on launch and then there is a continuous downside. Except the downside these days seems to be a lot more. Last year, for example, we saw that the price erosion is close to 15%. This has been exacerbated by, in fact, continuous channel consolidation happening. The second part of the story is that you find that the competition is also kind of intensifying. About 5-6 years ago, or perhaps 8 years ago, you found that there were not more than about 8 to 9 players for any molecule which we introduce in the U.S. And as I read today, there are close to about 25, 26 filings for every year in a molecule. That means there's going to be intensifying competition. If you look at, in fact, GDUFA as it plays out, in fact, the time for approval today has been expedited also. That only intensifies pressures much more.
We are all waiting for the next few years. 2020 is going to be extremely disruptive. And the way we are doing business as a pharmaceutical company is not the way it is going to be in 2020s. The whole Indian industry today, we have 300,000 reps meeting 1 million doctors trying to sell branded generics. Now, when the whole business model is going to change in the next 5 to 10 years, then what's going to happen to those people? So that's going to be one of the challenges. And if so, companies which have built up the business based on branded generics, how are they going to survive in the new millennium, where it's the cost of the drugs is going to be negotiated by a HMO who's going to have end-to-end service model for the patients? So this is going to be one of the big challenges which I foresee.
Directors of several pharmaceutical companies who have invested substantially in R&D programs got an opportunity to confer upon fostering innovation and creativity in their domains. The benefits of such investments were highlighted and a common perspective emerged through the panel discussion.
So today's discussion will be focused not only on new molecular entities and also generic research opportunities, but also in the area of sustainability using a green chemistry and flow technology. And the sustainability is going to be a major challenge for India and China today because we inherited a lot of bad processes from the Western countries.
Infrastructure is not a problem. You know, I think process can also be generated if there is the right culture of, you know, of the curiosity as well as, you know, driven by the by the need to learn. But I think what I agree with Ramesh is that there is a, you know, a talent gap with people. You actually do not always have the people with the right training as well as right approaches. I think especially the disease biology, the disease biology expertise, and then I think we also lack some clinical expertise.
For me, it's all depends on how you develop as a company, what kind of model you are developing to get what you want from the system. If I tell you that if the way we did it, we identified that there is a gap. If you see only the Indian market. But there are functional expertises which are available here, which are best in class, maybe best in the world. And that's basically the formulation science and the formulation process scale-up and all. So we took that advantage of creating a team which is doing the formulation in India.
The afternoon session of the Pre-Connect Congress continued with another panel discussion wherein leaders from the biopharmaceutical and pharmaceutical companies spoke about bridging talent gaps. Panelists agreed on the fact that talent acquisition has been a perennial challenge and how the need for technically skilled workforce is the need of the hour.
We divide into three parts of it. Part A, that is something here, the freshers in the campus, what are the ability or the talent which has been required, and the middle management and the senior management. Three categories we divide into this. The differentiation factor for hiring that the campus recruit or their junior level, we always go for the communication skills. We don't look at the much of the institutions which have been high-fly institutions have been called. We go for the mediocre institutions where the people have been required for us. That is only the long tenure if they're going to be happening to this.
When we are talking of senior management, obviously there's a profiling exercise and we have a biocon profile where we try and see how much it matches. When we are talking to them and when we are trying to evaluate them, a large part of the question goes into what Mallikarjun was mentioning as BEI, though we don't use BEI, you know, as a tool in many cases, but essentially putting the person back into that situation. And those are real-time situations that we have seen people face in our organization.
Like any other big multinational organization these days, we also have our very strong talent identification models. And in Novartis, we have 3x3 grid model, which we called LASP, Learning Agility and Sustained Performance Model. Now, people who are identified on the higher side of the spectrum, they have a high learning agility, they are high potential resources who've been doing extremely well. I think for us, we do not keep them where they are. With every year, we give them stretch assignments, and with these stretch assignments, we are really testing the limit or the extent of their potential.
The final panel discussion of the day was on the topic, building and sustaining a culture of quality. Aspects like accountability and credibility of a leading position within the pharmaceutical company was discussed in detail.
If you want to really achieve the leadership position in building and sustaining the culture of quality, from the word leader, I've actually taken out the consonants and removed the vowels. So if we are actually working on L for leadership, D for disruptive actions, and in a way it can be even transformative actions, and R, which is for the resources, and I'm here talking about the competent resources. I think if we are able to work on these three verticals, we'll be definitely be able to achieve what we want to and give a greater pace to and the quality to what we are trying to do in terms of building and sustaining the culture of quality.
The facilities that we have are fantastic. Quality systems, procedures are in place. But that has to get married with the quality culture. As they say, quality systems, if the quality culture is not good, it can have the quality system for breakfast. So the very important part is building a quality culture.
The biggest challenge that Dow has identified, based on the information that we get from our market assessment, also from the customer interaction and the customer projects that we were doing, it's a clear customer pull that the need for the industry is how do you enhance drug viability, how do you improve productivity, how do you improve patient compliance with patient safety and biologics.
Well, I'm looking forward to watching the whole industry come together, networking, learning from one another. I'm looking forward to the Pharma Awards later on this evening, as well as two fantastic shows where we're going to see all the capabilities of industries domestic here in India and international. Very exciting. Really looking forward to it.
Coming up, the most awaited India Pharma Awards. Stay tuned. The most awaited moment of the event had arrived with the India Pharma Awards, where works by several pharmaceutical professionals were recognized and felicitated. More than 250 guests gathered to celebrate excellence in the industry. Most awardees were celebrated thinkers and creators, breaking new grounds in the field of pharma.
Tonight is all about acknowledging the best in the pharma industry and honoring them. So it is indeed the moment that we've all been waiting for. To present the first set of awards for the evening, I'd like to invite on stage Dr. Ajit Dangi, President and CEO of Danson Consulting. And may I also once again humbly invite Sri Subhash Desai to please come on stage.
After making India Week in Mumbai, this is another event we all are proud. And I congratulate each and every member of the industry for taking the pharma industry to this level.
Excellence in ancillary pharma services goes to Doshi Consultants.
Now, this award is for the category Excellence in Brand Product Consistent Performance.
Excellence in Brand Product and Consistent Performance. And the winner is Mylan India.
And to move on to our next category, which is Excellence in Brand Product New Launch, I'd also like to invite Mr. Chakravarti, AVPS, CEO and Managing Director of EcoBliss, to please come on stage.
Excellence in Brand, the product new launch is Eli Lilly and Company India Private Limited. Congratulations.
Mighty congratulations, and thank you, sir, for doing the honors.
Excellence in contract research and manufacturing goes to Acum's Drugs and Pharmaceuticals Limited. Congratulations.
Acum's Drugs and Pharmaceuticals Limited is the largest contract manufacturer, as they manufacture 12% of India's total medicine consumption. Our next category is Excellence in Corporate Social Responsibility, companies with turnover more than 500 crores. So to give away this award, I'd also like to invite on stage Mr. Deepnath Roy Chaudhary, the Managing Director of Strassenberg Pharmaceuticals Limited.
And the winner is Lupin Limited.
The honours, may I please invite on stage Mr. Satish Wagh, Chairman and Managing Director of Supriya Life Science Limited.
The excellence in the corporate social responsibility companies with turnover 500 crores on it. There are two winners. One is Janssen and the second is Health Solution. Congratulations.
So let's double up the applause, ladies and gentlemen. We've got two winners in this category. Yes, ma'am. Let's have the team of Health Solutions first up. Big round of applause, ladies and gentlemen. Let's hear it for Team Janssen. I'd like to invite on stage Marina Wyatt, who's the Group Chief Financial Officer with UBM PLC. So can we have a huge round of cheer, ladies and gentlemen?
And the winner is Globala Pharma PVT Team Limited.
So
present this award, may I please invite on stage Professor Pierre Pienaar, the President, WPO. Once again, to please come on stage. So the winner is?
And the winner in excellence in health and safety goes to Piramal Pharma Solutions.
Piramal Pharma Solutions is a CDMO offering end-to-end services required to bring a drug to the market. Congratulations. And to do the honours for our next category, may I please invite on stage Dr. Ajit Dangi to please come on stage. Ladies and gentlemen, our next category for the evening is Excellence in Marketing.
Excellence in Marketing, Himalaya Drug Company.
So to present the award, I'd like to invite on stage Mr. Jimmy Singh, the CEO of UBM Asia, to please come on stage. And the award goes to?
So the winner of Excellence in Patient Engagement is Mylan India.
To do the honours, I'd like to invite on stage Dara Patel, the General Secretary with IDMA, to please come on stage.
The award goes to Aurobindo Pharma Limited.
Aurobindo Pharma Limited is a global pharmaceutical company exporting its products in more than 150 countries. To do the honours, I'm going to invite on stage Mr. Michael Duck, Executive Vice President, UBM Asia, to please come on stage.
For excellence in pharmaceutical machinery and instruments, ACG Pampac Machines Private Limited.
Honours, I'd like to invite on stage Dr. R.B. Smartha, Managing Director, Interlink Technologies. And so the winner is?
Zim Laboratories Limited.
Congratulations. And thank you, sir, for doing the honours. Congratulations, ma'am. To do the honours, I'm going to invite on stage Mr. Yogesh Mudras, Managing Director, UBM India. And the winner is?
So the winner in this category is Ideal QS Private Limited. Congratulations.
Ideal Cures is one of India's leading manufacturers and exporter of pharmaceutical excipients and ready to use coating systems for solid oral dosage forms. Congratulations. To do the honours, I'd like to invite on stage Mr. Deepnath Roy Chaudhary, Managing Director of Strasbourg Pharmaceuticals Limited.
Excellence in skill development. The winner is Aurobindo Pharma Limited.
Congratulations to Aurobindo Pharma Limited. To do the honours, may I please invite Mr. Sumit S., Associate Director, Andhra Pradesh E-Commerce Development Board. And so the winner is?
And the winner in Operational Excellence Manufacturing is Lupin Limited.
Let's have a louder round of applause to keep that momentum on. Next category is Operational Excellence Supply Chain. To do the honors, may I please invite Mr. S.M. Mudda, Director, Global Strategy, Microlabs.
The award for Operational Excellence Supply Chain goes to Dr. Reddy's Laboratories Limited.
Dr. Reddy's has global footprints with presence across 26 nationalities with global workforce and still growing every day. I'd like to invite Mr. Rahul Deshpande, Group Director of UBM India, to please come on the stage.
Very happy to announce Special Recognition Excellence in Make in India Embellishment Award, Pariplast India.
A special round of applause, everyone, because it's all about excellence in Make in India enablement, Pariplast India Limited. Congratulations. I'm going to request Mr. Rahul Deshpande to please remain on the stage. And I believe you're going to be taking over for the next category.
Mr. A.V.S. Chakravarti also has this unique honor to be the first Asian to be appointed as the global ambassador for the WPO. A loud round of applause for Mr. A.V.P.S. Chakravarti.
So let's have a huge round of applause one more time for Mr. A.V.P.S. Chakravarti, Managing Director, EcoBliss. To present this award, I'd like to once again invite on stage Mr. Yogesh Mudras, who's a Managing Director of UBM India. So I'm going to invite you on stage to present this award. This is the Industry Crusader of the Year.
So this year, the Industry Crusader of the Year, the award goes to our very own, we all know, Dr. Sudhanshu Pandey. Unfortunately, Dr. Pandey couldn't come, so Dr. Satish Vaz is going to accept this award on his behalf. Dr. Vaz, may I request you to please come on stage?
So our next category, ladies and gentlemen, Women Leader of the Year. So to do the honors, I'd like to invite on stage Professor Pia Piena, President WPO, and Mr. Jimmy Singh to please come on stage.
Woman Leader of the Decade, and the winner is Kiran Masumdar Shaw.
That's right, ladies and gentlemen, and the award goes to Dr. Kiran Masumdar Shaw. Ladies and gentlemen, we do have a representative from Biocon. That's right, ladies and gentlemen, the founder and chairman and managing director of Biocon, Dr. Kiran Masumdar Shaw, the winner of the Woman Leader of the Year. However, we have a team here to receive the award on her behalf. Thank you very much, sir. Our last category for the evening, this is the Lifetime Achievement Award. To present this award, I'd like to invite on stage Mr. Deepnath Roy Chaudhary, managing director of Strassenberg Pharmaceuticals Limited. And may I also invite Mr. Tim Cobbold, Group CEO, UBM PLC, to please come on stage.
It goes to the person we all know for decades in the pharma industry for his contribution, Dr. Ajit Dange.
Ladies and gentlemen, let's have a huge standing ovation to honor Dr. Ajit Dange, President and CEO, Danson Consulting. Thank you very much, sir. I'm going to request all the winners to please come on stage for a group picture.
India is already being recognized as a pharmacy of the world. But you know, we have to move up the value chain from cost arbitrage to intellectual arbitrage. And for that, we have to use innovation as a platform. So when these people see the excellence and innovation, these who have done this get an award, people get inspired, other companies get inspired, and the company which gets award works harder to get more awards next year. So that is the whole thing about UBM awards. You know. Yeah.
Day 4 of India Pharma Week was dedicated to the women entrepreneurs in the industry. The theme, Aspire, Lead and Inspire, initiated a venerable platform which successfully brought together renowned and accomplished women leaders under one roof. Speakers and panelists in this segment shared their success stories, experiences and knowledge.
What I wanted to do today was to talk to you a little bit about my perspectives on women in boardrooms, but I also want to share some data and insights from third-party companies with you, and then, you know, just bring together that with my own observations. So hopefully that will, help set the scene and see, you know, that a lot of the challenges we're dealing with in UK companies are probably very similar to the challenges being dealt with all around the world. So I'm delighted to be here today, and thank you for asking me to do this.
It is extremely important that this event is being organized about women in the pharma sector. The issue is being debated and talked about all around about women leaders and in various sectors. And the pharma industry being so important to the economy, it's equally critical that we meet a lot of people who are in the sector, who are going to be working in the sector and working their way up as leaders of the future.
Apart from discussing on several nuances of female leadership, popular brands also got an opportunity to present their innovative products.
Why does Dow have a diversity goal? You know, it's very important to think that, is diversity really important for everyone or everyone in your organization? It's a very healthy statistic to see that diversity and inclusion is not encouraged by an organization for the sake of it. But there is a reality, there is a fact behind having women or having a diversity involved in an organization.
With an increase in sensitivity among several pharma organizations on gender diversity, panelists of this discussion believe that firms are keeping inclusion as one of their strategic priorities. The discussion also highlighted the need to include the women workforce for better financial results.
I will share with you two levels of the structure, one at a global level and the other at the India level. So it gives you a context of the different possibilities. So first things first, at the global level, our executive committee has part of their individual variable remuneration, their bonus, dependent on how much and what they do to promote gender diversity in particular. So globally, obviously, diversity is a topic, but gender diversity in particular is related or linked to their IVR, as we call it at Sanofi.
The key focus areas for women leaders of Abbott is, it's three areas: connect, inspire, grow. How do we create opportunities for women to network more? Research and, of course, practical experience shows men network more, women don't, and that's an area we focus on.
In an exclusive interview with Amira Shah, the Managing Director of Metropolis Healthcare, the evolving role of women leaders was discussed in detail.
Well, Amira, you know, just to start with that, what's your experience been, say, vis-a-vis 5 years from now, 5 years from before, in terms of women participating in corporate India? Has it improved? Has it worsened? Are we the same?
I think things are much better, actually. I think... of course, you know, if you compare it to 500 million women or 700 million people that live in India today, are we where we should be? Of course not. And I think we all know that. But that's also, by the way, true globally. I don't think globally women are at the place where they need to be in most other countries either. So I think we all know that this is a very long-term fight and a long battle. It's not one that's going to be achieved and, you know, won overnight. But I think if we do look at it in perspective, and we do look at it in hindsight compared to 5 years ago, I do think there's a significant change. I think you are seeing a lot more women in positions of importance. I think you're seeing women having more than, you know, what the rest of the external situation, or the external ecosystem is stopping them. A lot of the times women actually stop themselves, right? Mm. A lot of the times they have their own personal situations at home, their own lack of confidence issues, their own inability to say that, look, I can manage both, or in the words of Indra, no, you have it all. So a lot of the times, I think women themselves stop themselves, and I think that confidence has changed. So I think women are now saying, you know what, I'll find a way to balance it. I'll figure it out. If my mother-in-law is restricting me at home, you know I'll figure out a way to deal with it. If my kids are making me feel guilty, I'll find a way to deal with it. And I think that has been the biggest change, if you ask me.
The summit accommodated exhibitor showcases in different locations in Mumbai. In its 11th edition, CPhI and P-MEC India inaugurated its 4-day pharma exhibition. With more than 1,500 exhibitors from 40 countries, this showcase is South Asia's largest pharma event, making it a perfect opportunity for potential business partners to mingle.
I'm very, very, very impressed with the CPhI. And every year, it's been just growing and multiplying. And it's given me a lot of information and a lot of help to grow my business.
The fifth day of India Pharma Week comprised of a strategic gathering of industry thought leaders, an exclusive closed-door CEO roundtable. Top management of leading pharma companies engaged in thought-provoking, solution-driven discussions on key challenges.
My request to you is actually to ignore the graphs, ignore the numbers. Like, try and go past those numbers and what are the trends? What are they telling us? How do we interpret it? And I think that's what we need to focus on as a group.
Training and it continues. So there's a lot more strong skills in chemistry, strong skills in quality, strong skills in manufacturing. And the fact that there's a strong local formulation industry helps. Across this obviously also means that we also have high quality manufacturing facility. We've already been talked about the fact that we are the second largest number of US FDA approved facilities outside of the US. You can see the data. The first number is the US, the yellow number is India, and the dark gray is everybody else put together.
I will comment on four key elements as has been mentioned in the UBM handout today. One, access and affordability, quality compliance, which you also talked about, innovation and regulatory infrastructure, and what can industry do in all of these four elements. Message which needs to go is balancing between pricing and availability.
The event concluded with a panel discussion where CEOs conferred upon the latest trends and their challenges within the industry.
I think this was a very fascinating session and a very invigorating session, and we had some of the leading thought leaders and eminent minds of this country talk about a few of these topics.
The amount of focus that was given on the quality and compliance, I felt we should have another CEO roundtable for quality and compliance alone. That was the kind of interest we generated, and as you rightly said, we need to take this whole experience from the learning mindset and not victim mindset, because it applies to all. But then if you learn sooner than the others do, it will be a strategic competitive advantage for us, I think.
I don't want industry to be complacent or media to take a view that, yes, all CEOs are committed or everything is okay. We have taken initial steps. You won over the confidence of the regulators, the global regulators, that, yes, we mean business, we are serious. But a lot of homework needs to be done. And I won't blame even only the leaders or the CEOs to change what is happening.
I represent Formaxel as the vice chairman. And we urge our ministry, which is Ministry of Commerce, that let's get together with Ministry of Health, Niti Aayog, and what have you, under the dynamic CEO of India, right, Shri Narendra Modi, create an ecosystem wherein the government comes forwards and becomes a facilitator, does a role change from a policing or a regulator to a facilitator, and take it forwards, particularly for the MSME sector, the tiny sector, the medium sector, which accounts for, ladies and gentlemen, an astounding 70% of the manufacturing in volumes.
I think Pharma Week is a huge opportunity for
all the players in the pharmaceutical industry to have one platform for that week. In many instances around the world, the exhibitions of this nature are very focused on one particular area. But yeah, in this one, you've got all the players, the machine guys, the components, the packaging, and all the various ingredients. And in pharmaceutical, it's a massive industry on its own, just the ingredients. But to have everyone together is such an advantage for the customer, because they can then take each issue they have and evaluate it all under one roof. So a massive opportunity. And certainly this particular was an eye-opener for me.
India Pharma Week in its 11th year yet again proved to be a celebration of success for the country's pharma business. The event ended on a high note, where it acted as a grand stage for pharmaceutical companies and leaders.
CPhL India, PMEC, India Pharma Week, a UBM event. Focus. Ideate. Innovate. Enable.
I'm very, very, very impressed with the CPhI. And every year, it's been just growing and multiplying. And it's given me a lot of information and a lot of help to grow my business.